So initial few years of, I would say any career would be difficult. I don't know how things have changed, but yeah, when now young kids who work with me, they come up, you know, unhappy at times, and that's what I tell them, that, you know, I can't give you a real big picture on what you're doing and how much it's changing the world or the organization, because it's not. A lot of times it's simple work, you know, and you have to do it because it's work, in the sense that somebody has to do it, and sorry, you're young and you're the youngest in the team, you have to do it. So first few years were difficult, and then I think it isn't like you plan your career, and then somebody says that, you know, how did you plan your career? You never plan it, you know, it's pretty, you know, you just look at the next step and the next decision, and then one thing leads to the other, and then eventually you look back and you see, oh, 20 years have gone by and half your life, more than half your life is over. The realization that time that you have with you is finite, you know, and and what you can do with that time is also limited, in the sense that you have only so much time. Your career is finite. When you're young, you always think, oh, there's enough time, you know, and there's, you know, you never question that. You always think there's enough time for everything in the world, and hence you keep trying things, you keep making mistakes, you keep jumping from one job to the other. You never really think whether it's adding value to yourself or your life or your, you know, world in general. You don't think about these things. You just think about the next paycheck and then the 20% hike over it or the 40% hike over it, you know. But I think after you reach a certain age, you realize that time is all you have, in the sense that as a corporate employee, what are you doing? You're selling your time, right? So I have become very finicky and very possessive about my time. And not just in the corporate space or the workspace, but even in my personal life. So, and when you start looking at life through that lens, that you have only so much, everything is finite, and time definitely is. Nobody lives forever, right? And your career is not forever. There's only a certain number of years that you have. So you might as well do the best in those years that are given to you, and you might as well do what makes you happy, rather than living a version of life which somebody prescribes for you. And a lot of times when you're younger, you know nothing about anything actually, and you just go by what is prescribed to you as a format of career and format of life and format of relationships and just format of, you know, everything which is like a fairy tale version of life that exists. But life doesn't pan out like that, and I think with age you realize that it is not a fairy tale, and you know, there are certain things which will not turn out the way you envision it to be, and you just take that in your stride and take her next step forward and then the next step forward and just keep going like that. You can't really plan for the next 5 years or 10 years down the line, but yes, what you can plan is for the immediate future, and hopefully what you're choosing is something that makes you whole and makes you complete. And I think that's where the bigger struggle lies. You know, the first step is to really understand what is it that you're looking for. And I think people do not invest a lot of time in that question. Because if you would invest time in that question, then you would save yourself a lot many years of pain that will follow if you make a wrong decision. And even this piece, that what is it that I'm looking for, that also keeps changing. Because what was right for me maybe 10 years earlier is not right for me at this stage in my life. You know, so I think it's a, you know, conscious and a constantly revisitable question which you have to have a dialogue with yourself very frequently. And I think with age you get the strength and the courage to really one, look out for that answer, and then when the answer presents in front of you, you accept that answer. So a lot of people have asked me that, why did I leave a brand like Apple, you know, and that's exactly where it came from. If you know, after a certain age, you do not really follow what is right for everybody, because what's right for somebody else might not be right for you. And I think when you're young, you do not have that conviction. You've not seen life enough. You've not had exposure enough. You don't know what lies on the other side. But I think after a certain age, you become, if not stronger, I think just you do not care much about what others say. So I think, because strength is something that's, again, you know, it's something which is It varies because the sort of strength that you need now, maybe a year down the line when situations are different, you will, you know, that's not a benchmark, and it that gradient of strength keeps varying. But I think when you reach a certain age, you just stop caring, and I think that gives you a lot of, at least for me, all of this is personal, right? And I don't know how it pans out for anybody else, but I think it gives you a certain sense of freedom to choose what is right for you, and I think that has worked for me. For any business, the oxygen for a business is cash, you know, and I think a lot of times when you grow really big, there are so many elements to that business, you forget about that piece. Rest everything is immaterial, you know, so in any crisis you need to start conserving cash, and you need to do whatever it takes to conserve as much cash as possible to at least help you tide through that phase that you at least, you know, even right now, for example, we do not have visibility on how things will turn out. If you ask me questions on what do I think will happen to business a few months down the line, I would say I don't know, and honestly I don't know that this is how the world will shape up, or, you know, you and I will end up having a conversation 8 in the night, you know, on a Zoom call. We don't know, right? So what we do know is and what we can do, any crisis, you have to start conserving cash for your business. So through whatever means possible, reduce that gestation period of getting the cash back into the system. Now there are various ways in which you can do it, and there are things that you can attempt to try and do it, but not all of it will be successful. You know, you like I said, none of us have all the answers, but are we clear on what needs to be done? Again, we know what is needed, like cash is needed for the business. Now forgetting that, there are a few things that you know should be done. Now, which one will succeed in the current situation, you don't know, but you try attempting it, you know, you make a few, you know, decisions here and there, and, you know, you start putting things in motion, and you pray, and after that, you just pray, hoping that some of it will click. But that's on the business side. On the personal piece, I think what this phase has done, and which I think again a lot of us are not paying attention to, and especially when I work with a team which is very young, is you know, this entire how this phase is impacting your mental stability. Because as long as you are mentally sound and, you know, emotionally resilient, there's nothing that you can't do, there's nothing that you cannot ride through. But anyways, I think the world had become a little bit more lonelier with, you know, and work was one thing where everybody was investing themselves completely into, you know, so you did not miss the real relationships that probably our parents had in their generation, right? There was a sense of community living almost when we were growing up. I don't know for you, you're much younger, but all of us in our generation would have had a joint you know, joint family sort of a environment, you know, when you were growing up. So there was a fabric of a society which was very codependent driven, you know, and whenever there was a crisis, you had a set of people to fall back on. There weren't any therapists, there weren't any counselors, but the family itself turned into one, you know, and every marriage will have problems, every family will have problems, every family sooner or later, you know, there'll be some financial thing, some child going awry, you know, but all of it was tackled through that set of people around you, that almost that fabric of society that existed at that point in time. Lately, we'd not had that. And by that I mean, like, even when I started working, since I started working, we've been living in a nuclear family in a city which is too huge and so busy with our work. And before the lockdown, I think in the past decades, I've not had the sort of time to myself. You know, I've not had the sort of time to really reach out to my family. You know, you would have a hushed, like a rushed 1 minute call in the morning, and that's about it, you know. And for days, maybe you might even forget to check on your parents, and you keep pushing it back, saying that, okay, I'm busy, oh, there's work, you know, and there was always something to do. There was always some travel to, there was some flight to catch, there was some more cities to cover, you know, and there was something or the other happening around your life. And now when suddenly everything, you know, became standstill, you realize the futility of it all, you know, and you realize that you've in that pace, you've really not invested in nurturing relationships, because relationships do not happen overnight, you know, and that sort of, and it maybe it, after a certain age, it doesn't actually happen, you know. When you're younger, it becomes easier to trust, and then you grow with people, and that's why I think, you know, marriages or whatever, you know, college friendships, those work longer, and those. So I think we are at that stage where we do not have the luxury to differentiate between a digital initiative and a non-digital initiative, because digital is completely seamlessly integrated in our lives now. Now what you see digital, a lot of times people see the consumer front-ending piece of it, you know, so how you interacting with a consumer, how you getting feedback from him, how you reaching out to him. But again, in a business, that's the last step. Before you even do that, there's so many things in which digital is being used, like right from demand planning, to the way you stock and monitor that, to the way you, you know, even every element of business, there is huge amount of technological intervention. So I don't think we right now can say that, you know, I am pushing digital or I'm not pushing digital. We have no option. Digital is it, you know. Now, whether it's about how you getting data, or how you interpreting the data, or how you reaching out to consumers, or what you're doing with that piece when the data comes to you on those consumers, those are the decisions that you need to take. But whether you have to be more on digital, less on digital, that doesn't exist anymore. So even if you're doing anything offline, which for you, you know, like if you say conventional, like if you're advertising on, for example, TV or, you know, a print medium, which in a conventional way is not digital, but the response that comes back to you, you are anyways interpreting it through a digital platform, right? And then what you do with the data that's coming to you again is a digital platform. So you have to work towards it. So, and going forward, I see more of that happening, much, much more of that happening. So all our trainings, which even with, for example, us, was mostly being done offline, everything has moved to online. So I think this crisis has acted as a very good catalyst to a certain extent. And things that we were pushing off, because now you realize after living with it for 3 months, there's so many stuff, you know, so many things that could have had happened, I would say, with much lesser cost and easy to execute than, you know, what at that point in time we were attempting to do. Just thinking that, okay, people are not ready for it. People will not understand it. People will not, you know, adapt to it. But hello, we just 3 months down the line and all my training is digital. And, you know, bulk of my team members are even in towns where, small towns, and, you know, where a lot of times maybe even connectivity might be an issue at times, right? But they're trying to figure that out, and you know, we trying to work around it and trying to be as flexible around it. And I think this sort of a module helps us do that, you know, that reaching out has become much more easier. And mentally, I think now we do not push off ideas saying, okay, you know, we're not ready for it, it's too digital, if you like, you would say, you know. A lot of manufacturing organizations, I think the first apprehension is that you know, whether people will adapt to it. But I think that fear has gone off now. So in the coming few quarters, not even years, you know, I would say a lot of things will get pivoted. So for example, when I was pregnant, in the office that I used to work in, there was no place where you could rest, you know, and there wasn't any room where you could feed your baby as well. And and not that there weren't women, you know, it was a highly diversified organization. But I think because since there were no senior women at that point in time, nobody really thought through it. So a lot of times it's not the fact that people do not want to do it. A lot of times it's not even brought to their attention, so they just miss it, you know. So till I got pregnant, it wasn't that the junior women had not gotten pregnant or they had not struggled the way I was struggling, or but I think nobody managed to raise it. And even when you, as a woman also, you don't realize it till you really face it, right? That and I went through a bad patch when in the office time, and in that office I had a bad accident, so I had to be, you know, I had to use a place where I could lie down for a while, but there was nothing. So in the washroom I was lying down on the floor, you know, and because there was no place where you could do that. And later, you know, when I had a baby and I would carry him to work, there was no place where you could feed the baby. You know, and that is so basic needs for a woman, because you expect the woman to be back at work, and which I was, and many women that I work with would be back at work, and but you're feeding a child for the next year, year and a half. So how do you expect that to happen? And I think a lot of it is, I won't say deliberate, because people just don't know that this is needed, and hence they don't put as much thought and effort behind it. And a lot of times even you as a woman might be a little negligent about it, because you've not been through it, so you don't know what is needed. And and if you don't know, how will you help others? And I think a lot of women face that. You have a lot of self-doubt about yourself. And more than that, I think there's a huge amount of guilt, or you know, you're almost conditioned to think that if you do this, then you're letting go of a certain aspect of your life, be it motherhood, or be it a good marriage, or be it, you know, some format of relationship or a home. And to get that, you need to compromise on your career. You know, a lot of times, and I've heard this pretty often and many times, you know, that keeps playing. And even with me, I've realized that I have been doing that to myself. And anything which comes your way, the first thing that you evaluate is, A, if you are capable enough for it, or you know, whether you are okay to, whether you can even do it. And B, if you do it, will there be a huge amount of guilt, because it's eating out of your limited time that you have for your family, you know, and if whether you will manage operationally, you will end up managing everything together. So what I've trained myself to do, and honestly it's been a training, because you have to consciously, constantly keep talking to yourself and keep going against whatever your mind is telling you at every single point that the decision faces you. You have to learn to start saying yes more often. You have to constantly keep telling yourself that, you know, if something is coming your way, even before that self-doubt creeps in, because when something is coming your way, you don't know how will it shape up. You don't have to have all the answers with you at that point in time. You don't have to really know how will it get executed. You don't need to have everything with you at that point in time. What you need to do is to just have the faith and the conviction and the strength to say that yes. You know, the moment you say that yes, then the rest of the things start falling in place. You know, then you figure out on the way. And it might be a new job, it might be a new project, it can be anything. It can be a speaking assignment, or something, you know, like a course or a writing assignment that comes your way. Before you say no to it, and before you say that, okay, maybe I'm too busy and, you know, my life is too full and there's so much at work, and then there's house and there's a child and there's a dog and there's a, you know, there's so much that's happening around you, maybe you will not manage to balance it out. I would just say that try it out. And I think as a woman, a lot of times we put ourselves right at the end of our priority list, right? As a mother, I realized that till I am not happy, I cannot make anybody else happy. I can definitely not make my child happy. And that's one thing that people forget, you know, in your urge to do too many things, to get to reach many places, to do as much as possible in your career and your life, you forget that there is a limit to it. And if it's not making you happy, it's impacting your family's happy. It's a directly proportional thing, right? So hence you start making your choices which suit you rather than anybody else's definition of a life. Because now it's not for women, I think it works when you tell them that if you do this, your family will be happy. You know, if you tell them that if you do this, you will be happy, they feel there's, you know, it's not a nice thing to do. You know, it's a selfish thing to do. How can I ask for my own happiness, right? So sometimes asking or doing things for your own happiness, you feel is selfishness. But if you tell them that, no, you have to be happy, because if you aren't, your child is unhappy. You know, there's no way an unhappy person cannot make anybody else happy. Be it your child or your family or any other relationship at work, you just cannot, you know. So you stop fooling yourself. So the first priority is to do stuff that makes you happy. And hence you take decisions which make you happy. And those decisions are very personal. What fits me might not fit you. You know, what the format of life or career, or, you know, that relationship between work and life and career or motherhood, all of that equation is something which is very personal to you, and only you can define it.